Anyways, welcome back to the Project Gen X podcast. I am one of your hosts, Alan Smith, along with...
I'm the other guy, Big Dave.
And we're this summer in 2021. It's hard to even imagine that we're saying 2021 for one thing, and for another, we're kind of like,
yeah.
Oh God, I can't believe it's been 30 years since this happened. But yeah, in the summer of 1991, I don't have the actual date. Dave might be able to pull it up.
I'm looking for it.
A little movie you might have heard of by the name of Terminator 2: Judgment Day was released.
Release date was July 1st, 1991.
So as we're recording this
in Los Angeles, the wide distribution release date was July 3rd.
Okay.
So this was a 4th of July weekend blockbuster movie.
Yep. And it was. This was the biggest movie of the year.
Yes.
And
in my opinion, the best of all of them.
We'll get into a lot of that because I have thoughts and...
You always do.
And I know you do as well.
You always do.
Terminator 2. Okay, before we even get into the movie, I want to say this. In the very early 90s, you started seeing a lot, and I mean a lot, of consumer tie-ins to movies. When I was rewatching, I'll be honest, I didn't finish watching the entire thing before we sat down, but I've seen the movie so many times, I just wanted to go back and kind of refresh myself on some stuff.
Yeah.
I can't believe how many times Pepsi shows up in the first, 45 minutes of this movie. You know, people walking through this big Pepsi machine, or they got a Pepsi in their hand with, the logo just pointed perfectly at the camera. I remember the Pepsi commercials.
Every fast food restaurant that was a Pepsi franchise...
Taco Bell.
...was doing the Terminator collector
cups. Exactly. Yeah. Taco Bell was the big one on that. I remember that. But the biggest piece of... I mean, the... biggest piece of promotion that they did was the video for You Could Be Mine by Guns N' Roses.
Yeah,
okay,
absolutely.
We're going to talk about that before, because that hit a month before this movie did. And it was one of those things.
And it was basically a trailer for the movie.
Of course, it had, as a lot of music videos did at the time, and going forward, that would have a movie soundtrack. It would have clips from the movie in it and that kind of stuff. This one went a step further, and Arnold Schwarzenegger actually appeared in the music video.
Walking through the crowd.
Right.
It was almost a recreation of when he was walking through the nightclub in Terminator.
A little bit, yeah. And it was kind of, and at the very end of the video, it shows the guys come walking out of the back door of the club, and he's standing there, and they all kind of look at him they're showing it through his HUD display, And he's like, each one of them, it'll say, Slash guitar player, blah, 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 and this and that. And it says, at the very last one, it's Axl Rose, and it shows him standing there, and it says, it pulls in on him, and it says, W. Axl Rose, the singer, or Target acquired, and it says, lead singer, and at the bottom of it says, assessment, waste of ammunition.
Yes.
And they just stand there and look at each other for a second, and Arnold kind of smiles at him, and they start to turn away from each other, and that's the end of the video. Yeah.
How little did we know that it actually would turn out to be true, that he would be a waste of ammunition?
I still like Hank. I'm sorry. I'm still a big Axl Rose
fan. Don't get me wrong. I love Guns N' Roses.
But. Well, the thing about it, the concert footage, obviously all the footage of Arnold walking through the crowd is not at that particular concert.
No.
That concert was in New York City. I remember when this happened, because it was one of those things that it was MTV News covered it and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
They did a club, it was at a club in New York City that they shot all of that, and they were, and this was, okay, so this would have been in May or June or somewhere around in there. Might have been in April, last part of April or something, because it's one of those things that we were still a few months away from the Use Your Illusion albums being released.
Yeah.
And this was the first single that was released off of that album, plus it was also on the soundtrack,
Yeah.
And they did that whole... They basically went in there and they're like, hey, we're doing a concert here, but we're also shooting a music video. So all of that stuff, there's some really cool concert footage in there. Like, there's one I remember, again, watching an MTV news where they're like talking to them, you know, after the show and everything. And it was funny because like there's a shot in the video where Duff like takes his bass off and jumps into the crowd, you know, like stage dives. And he said that when he came back, somebody stole his wallet. It's like, why did you have your wallet in begin with? You know, that's kind of
you kind of got to leave that in the dressing room,
you know, and all that kind of stuff. But it's kind of one of those. I always loved the video for that footage. It's a music video of its time, where it is a lot of music, like of live concert footage and stuff, which Guns N' Roses people tend to forget. We've talked about it a few times, covered it. Their big breakout was when Paradise City,
which was a live concert video.
Exactly, with them playing, I think it was in the Meadowlands, if I'm not mistaken. And they were opening.
That seems correct.
I think they were opening for Aerosmith at the time or something, you know, because it's one of those things that music video is like iconic.
Yeah.
With all of that concert footage and stuff.
And Steven Tyler, I think, used to complain about having to go on stage after them because they were blowing the roof off of everywhere. Right.
And, you know, so it's one of those things that, like I said, this was the biggest tie-in to the movie was the song and the scene, which is funny because, again, when I started watching the movie, you know, John Connor, you know, when he's with his little buddy and they're on the bike and everything, they play the song like three times.
Yeah. Or keep playing the song. Yeah, keep
every time they keep coming
the
back and they're playing it again and they're playing it again. I'm like, I don't have a problem with that because it's a freaking awesome song to begin with.
But his redheaded friend looks so familiar to me. I cannot place what movies.
Big. He was Josh's best friend in Big.
Oh, that's right.
I know. I was watching that too. I was like, that's the kid from Big. Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's another one before we really get into it. Okay, so this was a James Cameron movie. You know, he had done the original Terminator.
Yep.
And the original Terminator, produced and directed by. The original Terminator came out in 1984. It was not a big hit in the theaters.
No.
But once it hit home video, it got a following like you wouldn't believe, and it made all kinds of money.
I mean, that's where I saw it.
That's where I saw it too. Yeah, I know. It's the same thing. And so it was one of those things he had been trying for a while to make the sequel, to make this movie.
Yeah.
And he couldn't get the funding because, again, it wasn't a blockbuster at the, you know. It was after he did Aliens, which was like 2 years later. I think it was in 86, I think it was, when
Aliens
was on.
Something like that, yeah.
That was kind of what gave him the clout of like, hey, look, I just did a sequel to a movie that was a moderate success in the theaters, and this was a big blockbuster.
Yeah.
Like, it did well, you know, so I want to do my movie over here. Of course, he also went and he did The Abyss before this, which is actually where the technology for the T-1000 was developed, you know, with all that stuff.
Which, if you haven't seen The Abyss, that's another one you should go
that
back
is
and
a,
watch.
Yes, that is a good movie. That was one that I came to later.
Oh, know? Really?
Like, I didn't see it before this. Like, it was one of those. I'll be honest, I saw it after this because I had heard about, like, my mom was a big fan of The Abyss. Again, going to my mom, loving her sci-fi movies. My mom was a big fan of The Abyss and kept talking about how good it was and everything. And I was like, I don't care about, you know, underwater. I didn't even know what it was about, to be honest. I knew it was something underwater, but it was one of those things that it came out after both Leviathan and Deep Star 6, and I was like, I've seen both of those movies. I don't need to see another underwater monster movie, you know?
No, I saw The Abyss, but I saw it in VHS on the VHS release, and I wanted to see it because the box itself looked awesome.
Yes, it did.
And the description of the movie on the back of the box was kind of, I was like, yeah, I gotta see this. Right. This is gonna be good.
So, but here's the thing. James Cameron loves to reuse his same actors.
Yes, he does.
And of course, he married Linda Hamilton. So, you know, that was, you know, which I think they were just married or they got married shortly after this one. I can't remember.
One
exactly.
or the other.
Yeah. And then they got divorced after Titanic, which, good on her. That means she got a ton of money.
Can you imagine how that dinner table talk went? It's like, you actually made this movie and released this movie? I want a divorce.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he was having an affair, so that was, it was, and if I'm not mistaken, it was, he was married, made Terminator 2, met Linda Hamilton, they got together, and so he divorced his first wife, and then he got together with somebody on the crew or something while making Titanic, and so then he got divorced from Linda Hamilton. So apparently, it's if you're working on a movie with James Cameron, there's a good chance you could wind up his next girlfriend or wife or something. So.
His next ex-wife, if you want to get technical about
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. Anyway, well, the reason why I say he reuses is that, did you recognize the stepmom?
Okay, what did he...
She... The stepmom. You okay, know, the, okay. Or not okay. stepmom, but the foster mom. I'm sorry.
What was she from then?
She's from Aliens. It's Vasquez.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah.
I didn't even notice that.
There's one even better, though.
Okay.
She's in Titanic. You've seen Titanic. I know you have. Everybody's
yeah,
seen Titanic.
Because I was, yeah.
You remember the mom with the two kids and she's telling the bedtime story whenever the ship's sinking?
Yeah.
That's Vasquez.
Okay.
Yeah, same actor and all those roles.
Okay.
Yeah, it's one of those things that, you know, it's we've seen Bill Paxton show up in a bunch of stuff. You know, we saw Lance Henriksen show up in a bunch of stuff. And, you know, it's one of those things, he reuses the same actors over and over. And she, I wish I knew her name off the top of my head.
Hold on.
She'll always be Vasquez.
I can probably pull the cast up here real
but,
quick.
But yeah, that's other cool thing about this, man. Like, we haven't even started talking about the movie yet. This was like... It wasn't his first role, but this was where we all were introduced to Robert Patrick. And
yeah,
that steely gaze that he has is just...
Yeah, it's creepy. It's creepy. And he uses it to great effect in Scorpion also. Did you ever see a TV show, Scorpion?
No, I didn't.
Oh, you really should watch that. That's a good show.
I've seen him. You know, of course, yeah, he wound up on The X-Files, you know, later. And this was also because it actually says...
Jeanette Goldstein.
Yeah. It actually says introducing Edward Furlong.
You
know, on that was his very first movie. Let's see. Let me pull up Robert Patrick here, and let's see what his first thing was. Come on, wow, he's been in a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
You know what? No actor. Yeah, he had been in a few things. Nothing.
Probably smaller roles.
He was in Die Hard 2.
He was in Die Hard 2?
Yeah, he played O'Reilly. I don't know.
I don't recognize that at all.
Might be one of the cops or something. Everything else, it's like The New Adventures of Lassie and some low budget Equalizer 2000, Warlords from Hell, like some B movie stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So this was his big breakout.
Good for him.
You know,
this is also the movie that started the Harley Davidson fat boy craze.
Yes.
Everybody in the world wanted that
I remember, of course, you know, from seeing the music video, you know, there was the shot of them on the bike running from the tow truck that the T-1000 is driving, you know, and that kind of stuff, which we're going to come back to that in a minute, okay?
Yeah,
because there's something in there that I was really noticing last night that I'd noticed before, but last night it was really standing out. I remember watching the movie. I did not see this movie in theaters. I saw it when it was released on home video later. Because I didn't get a chance to, for whatever I had, whatever was going on that summer, I just never got a chance to go see it. And so it was one of those things, I saw it later, but him, when he goes into that biker bar at the beginning and he gets the clothes and then the bike, you know, and kind of stuff, that I remember then going, like, that was like kind of starting to reignite my love of motorcycles and thinking, man, that's an awesome bike, you know, and that kind of stuff. And so yeah, there's a lot to unpack there.
What I have learned in the years since, and talking to guys who ride bikes, because I'm actually looking at maybe getting my license and getting a bike myself. Mm-hmm. Those things are terrible to ride if you have a heavy crosswind, because those wheels are solid.
Oh, yeah.
And they are evidently a huge wind catcher and will push you right off the road.
I don't know. Arnold looked cool on that bike is what it came down to. Arnold Schwarzenegger was like, what, 40-something when they made this movie?
Probably.
I want to say, because I know he's in his 70s now. Of course, you know. I'll tell you the other thing. You know, there was the iconic... Like I said, we haven't even gotten into the movie yet. This is just all the stuff around the movie, you know. There was the big, you know, in the first Terminator, the big thing was the catchphrase, you know, "I'll be back."
Yeah.
They put a big push on the Hasta La Vista Baby.
Yeah, they did.
Like, that was in the Pepsi commercial and in the Taco Bell commercial.
Hasta La Vista. baby.
Yeah, that was like, they were like, oh, we're going to make this a thing.
Oh, it's going to be, and it was for a little bit. For a little bit.
Now, the I'll Be Back has, actually, I think the line that has stuck from this movie is the,
come with me if you want to live.
Yeah, that's kind of been the line that stuck more than anything else. All right, let's get into the movie itself. So, yeah. And just for everybody that's listening to this, according to Terminator, we only got 8 years before the nukes go off. So it's 2029. So
many comments that I could make right here, but I probably shouldn't because I'd get in trouble.
Yeah, especially what we saw with Facebook getting ready to get into podcasting.
Yeah.
I mean, they're going to ruin that just like they're ruining everything else.
So. Yeah. Which, by the way, if they ruin podcasting, like I think they're going to, we're probably going to pull the page from Facebook.
Yeah, absolutely. So, anyway, well, but they also own Instagram, so, you know.
It's just a matter of time.
I know. So, anyway, the first one came out, so we're like 7 years later. I would say John's somewhere in that age range. I don't know.
Well, they actually named the time that the movie happens.
That's right. It happens in like 1993 or something.
1995.
Okay. I knew it was further than, it wasn't in 91. It was later. So,
yeah. So even in 91, they were like, let's make this 4 years
now. Yeah. Well, that was also, you get to age the kid up because she was pregnant at the end of Terminator.
Right.
Which would only put the kid at like 7 years old in 91, so you add 5 more years, he's 12 now, so you can make a you can cast somebody age appropriate in that, you know, without having to. So anyway, so she's in prison, or no, she's in a mental institute because and we learn an exposition dump from John Connor, from Little Johnny.
No,
we're not going to call him Little Johnny.
Oh no!
But we learned from John that he learned, like, he's hacking an ATM.
Yeah.
And he said, I learned from my mom. Said, you know, she used to shack up with like our next Green Beret and different guys who could teach her stuff. And that's how I learned all this stuff.
She's basically jumped from dude to dude who had specific skills that she could learn from to be able to teach, you know, John how to be the soldier he needs
to be. Absolutely. Now, actually, we actually open up with we're in the future. And there is a they show a battle between the resistance and the machines. That actually still looked pretty good.
Yeah,
you know, I was really, you know,
that whole the tracks going across the ground. You think it's rocks, and then the light hits the rocks. It's all skulls.
I know. And it's just like and you get that, you know, the Terminator foot crushing the skull, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And it's a pretty cool. I mean, even, you know, the battle scene itself, you know, they're fighting with lasers. It's not, you know, and that kind of stuff. And it's like, okay, this is actually pretty, especially for something that's 30 years old, this actually held up pretty well.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's a lot done in miniatures and stuff, you know.
A lot more practical. Except for the CG-heavy T-1000.
Yeah, we'll get to that in a minute.
Uh-oh.
No, I mean, it doesn't, we don't have to get to it. When we finally get to see the T-1000, you know, when he's going these transformation stuff, it still looks good, but it looks good as a, oh, this was ahead of its time.
Yeah.
It doesn't look as good as, now, here's the difference, though. That's all, you know, the CGI again, you know, early CGI and all this stuff. It looks good. Actually, it looks better than some modern CGI that I have seen. You know, that's like, it's one of those things that the big difference in it is that it doesn't look like it's actually a part of the film itself. It looks like it's like sitting on top of it more than anything.
I'll agree with that.
That's where like newer CGI does a good job of kind of blending better anyway. As opposed to this, but the actual effects themselves, sometimes I'm like, no, I could buy this as being a thing, as opposed to some modern CG stuff where I'm like, this doesn't even look like it would even be feasible.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, and then you get into the whole Uncanny Valley a lot of times, just that stuff where it's like, wow, this is okay.
It's like, wow, those eyes were completely CGI.
Exactly. 'Cause
there is no soul behind
that at all. But yeah, so, you know, they send, and the whole thing is a voiceover, right?
If
I guess saying that, and they're showing John Connor in the future.
It's basically, I can't remember if it's him or if it's her doing the voiceover. I think it may be her.
Is it her? Yes, it is her.
Yeah.
And then, you know, she says that they sent two, that they had originally sent one back and failed. And now that there was two being sent back, one to help and one to kill.
Yeah.
And it was just a matter of who got there first, you know, type stuff. So yeah, it's one of those things, you know, that hole in the mall, you know, again, that with Arnold walking through the mall with that box of roses that the shotgun is hidden in, yeah. You know, and all that, and then, like, you know, John getting trapped between
Terminators,
the two Terminators, and not know, and only thinking that one of them is an actual Terminator. He thinks one's a cop. And then he sees the other one with a gun is like, oh, this is actually happening, you know, yeah. Type stuff. And then we find out that, you know.
Which at that point he thought his mom was full of crap.
Right, right. It wasn't until all of this happened that all of a sudden he was like, wow, she was right, you know. And of course they go to break her out. And that's when of course she sees the T-500 and is like, no, you know, he's here to kill us. And John's trying to tell her, like, no, he's not here to kill us. He's here to help, you know. Which we'll talk about some alternate timelines of this stuff later. So, because this started it all. This is the movie really that started all of it.
It is.
And so basically we have a chase at that point is what it comes down to.
Yeah.
You know, they're on the run trying to keep John safe. The T-1000 is trying to
kill everybody.
I want to ask a question. Again, like I said, I didn't finish watching this movie, but even in the parts that I did, I want to say that the version that I have might have extended stuff in it because I didn't remember a few things, like Kyle Reese. Yeah, obviously I must have watched an extended version of it.
You must have watched an extended version of it. Kyle Reese was in your version of it?
When she's in the mental hospital,
yeah,
and when we first see her, you know, they're he's leading the interns through, you know, that kind of stuff, and then they're like, okay, give her some more Thorazine, you know, type stuff. You know, of course, you know, they beat her up and they put the Thorazine to make her go to sleep.
Yeah,
you know, that leads into when she wakes up. You know, she's having the dream about the nuclear explosion.
Yeah,
okay. The version that I was watching, in the dream, Kyle comes to see her. And it's actually the guy that played Kyle Reese.
Yeah, you watched an extended version.
Yeah, and it's like, and he's talking to her, and she's chasing him down the hallway and runs outside, and that's whenever she's at the fence.
No, and it just, the dream is her just at the fence.
Right, right. I thought that was right. I was like, I don't remember this being in here. And like, there was another scene that I can't remember off the top of my head that I was like, I don't remember this scene either. It's
it's like, wait a minute. You either watched an extended version or we need to have a conversation.
I did not watch the porn version, okay? I love that meme, though, that you see it every once in a while. I was like, wait a second. I think I downloaded the wrong Halloween movie. Or whatever, you know. I think this is the wrong X-Men. It's like, but yeah. So there were like I said, in the version,
definitely the wrong Star Wars.
Yeah, definitely. But yeah, so but that was apparently, and it was the actor that played Reese in the first one, and like he comes in, like she wakes, she's like, oh, you know, he's like, you know, I love you, and blah blah blah, but you got to go, you know, he's saying you got to go, you still got a mission, and blah blah blah, and then he walks out of the room, and she goes running down the hallway. That, after him,
I think I can see now why they cut that.
Yeah,
out of
it
the
didn't
final
make
cut.
It didn't. It was kind of one of those things where it was like, this is kind of no. I don't. Well, first off, like I said, I was confused. Like, I don't remember this.
It sounds at like all. That really slowed the storyline down.
Yeah. And like I said, there was another scene I can't remember off the top of my head that was in there. And I was like, I don't think this was in here either. But I don't remember what it was, and I'm not going to go run it down to see what they added
it. Let's not do that.
Of course, the first thing I did is I looked to see how long it was. It was like 2.5 hours. Like, I don't remember this movie being that long. I remember it being about 2 hours, but that's so that they must have put some more stuff into it.
There's got to be a link.
I'm sure there is.
Oh no, it went away.
But yeah, it basically becomes a chase, you know, the rest of the movie of them, you know, just trying to stay one step ahead of the T-1000. And of course, with his shape shifting abilities, you know, you don't get the, you can't assume that whoever is there is real.
Well, one, the T-500's already had the ability to copy anybody's voice,
right? Which he does, which he's talking does. To his stepmom.
Well, he
right?
was even doing that one in the first one. Mm-hmm. But now you can't just copy the voice. He can copy. Mm-hmm. He can replicate anything that he touches.
Right, right. And it's funny because, you know, that...
Which I have a bone to pick with this.
Okay, go ahead.
Because the T-500 talks about you can't, you know, he can't do complex machines.
Right.
He can't do, you know, moving parts or, you right. know, chemical. You know, only simple mechanical. And then he completely turns himself into other people, which the human body is a complex...
I know.
Mechanical
well,
machine.
The other thing that I had with it is like at the very first, because they always send them back, you know, they send them back, and when they come back, they're always naked, okay?
Yeah.
Which is the whole thing that, you know, the T-1000 kills the cop and takes his clothes. I'm like, wait a second. We see him morph into all kinds of stuff, of people with clothes on. Why did he yeah. have to... why did he have to take his clothes? It was
well, it's only fair. The T-500s and the humans
yeah,
have to
I
come
know,
through
I
naked,
yeah,
so
whatever.
The T-1000s have to come
know,
through naked also.
Well, that's yeah, that was more of a... We're going to put a couple of naked people on camera, you know. Just for those that don't know this, and this is... I found this very interesting whenever I learned it way back in the day. Robert Patrick is the brother of Richard Patrick, who played with Nine Inch Nails and was the front person for Filter.
Oh, really?
They're brothers.
I
and if you ever
no
look
idea.
At them,
yeah,
they
that,
look alike.
That makes sense.
But I'm like, how did two people from the same family make it in two different, you know, two different, you know, artistic
yeah.
fields, you know? Yeah, they're brothers.
That's interesting. I wonder why they never got Filter to do any of the other.
I don't know. Yeah. You know, that's a.
I guess I killed him in Terminator 2, so there's
yeah.
No,
well,
there's
but
no
but,
point
but he also did show up in Wayne's World. Remember?
Oh, that's right.
He's like he got that where it's
right.
He does the whole like T2 thing, you know, where he like runs down and everything.
Yeah,
yeah. And so he's but. That's just, you know, it's Wayne's World, you know. They have all kinds of...
137 minutes.
So that's 2 hours and 17 minutes. So I had an extra...
you must have watched
13
the,
minutes or so. For
yeah.
Extra 16 minutes. Yeah, so that was one of them. There's, I don't know. It's a you're gonna have to like kind of take the wheel on some of this because, like I said, I didn't rewatch all of the movie, and so it's not fresh in my head. I could get there for some of it.
I mean, it's fairly simple.
Oh, I remember what the other picture was. The other.
You wanted to talk about the tow truck.
Oh yeah. Well, I remember what the other the other scene that I saw that I was like, I don't think this was
okay.
actually in there. And I want to check something before I say.
Oh, okay.
Because I think there's another actor that was in this. I think it was him, and I was like,
and I hate to boil it down this simple, but it's easily Terminator shows up to kill kid, Terminator shows up to save kid. Two Terminators have a showdown and lots of people get shot. Except for the good Terminator, who's not allowed to shoot anybody or not allowed to kill anybody.
Correct.
So, yeah, one of my favorite scenes is when they're trying to get out of, what's the name of the company that actually ends up building the Terminators?
Talking about Skynet?
Well, it's...
Oh, yeah, it's, shit, what's the name of that?
I can't remember the name of the... But they're in that building trying to get out, and he's basically walking around kneecapping everybody.
Oh, yeah,
pop,
yeah.
Pop, pop. No one died. Ha ha ha.
I told you wrong.
Oh?
The kid that played Tim, his buddy?
Yeah.
That's Danny Cooksey. That he wasn't in, he was not in,
okay.
He wasn't in Big. He was on a very popular television show in the 80s. He was brought on later.
What was it?
Different Strokes.
He was on Different Strokes?
Yep. You remember Mr. Drummond got remarried?
Vaguely.
Like the last couple, like I think it was like the last two seasons or something like that.
Yeah.
And he played Sam. He was Mr. Drummond's step son.
Oh, okay.
And he was also, he's been, he was look, I'm looking through, he was on Salute Your Shorts and a few other few other things here and there. So yeah, so he had been around, but that he wasn't the one I was looking for. So the other scene that I think was not, that I think was a new an insert. They were at the lab, and you know what? I don't see his name, so maybe it's not him. They were at the lab where they were creating the new, and it was one of those things that shows the guy come walking. That shows like the lab, and this guy comes in. And he goes, "Hey, we got the new diagnostics on it. Where did this thing even come from?" And then one of the guys says, I asked that question once.
No, that's actually Dyson. Is that in there? That's actually in the original movie.
Did it show him go in to, like, he goes to security and he goes into a room and there's the hand and he's got a chip? And Okay. Yes, I guess I just didn't remember that exactly.
Cyberdyne, yeah.
Now, the thing that I have not, I can't.
Yeah, because he, like, trips over the garbage can and, like, has picked the garbage can.
Okay, that's it. Okay, yeah, so that was the other one that I didn't remember. Like I said, I had not seen this movie in quite a few years. So I was like, oh, okay. And I thought, I was wrong, but I thought that the security guard that he had that was Eugene Levy, but it's not. Because I kept looking at it going, dude, that sounds just like him. You know, and of course, he was much younger, you know, type thing. But it wound up not being him. But, yeah, so that was kind of the... That and I guess that was the only other one that I saw that I was like, oh, okay, blah blah blah. We were talking about that scene, that chase, which I have to say this. I was sitting there, I was watching it on my computer last night, and my son was in the room and he was playing on his games or whatever. Yeah. And he came over and like sat down next to me and started watching it with me, like right before that. And he was like, "What's this movie?" You know, I was like, "It's called Terminator," you know, but of course he's 7 years old, you know.
Yeah.
And that chasing, like when they're on the motorcycle, and where, you know, John Connor is on the dirt bike, you know, and he's going through the aqueducts and stuff.
Yeah,
and
LA River,
the LA River, yeah. And so it's one of those things where like all that's happening, and he was like really into it. Like he was just sitting there, his eyes were like wide watching the whole thing.
Oh yeah, because it's an awesome chase scene.
And then as soon as the chase scene was over and it was back into just normal stuff, he was like, okay. And he just got up and like started playing his game again.
Yeah,
he's like, I'm only here for the exciting stuff.
Well, I mean, you've got what's essentially a 12-year-old, which is he was probably more like 16.
No, he was younger than
was
that.
Was he younger he than that? Young, maybe 14? Yeah.
He was, so, hold on, I'll tell you how old he was.
So you got it right here. In the storyline, you've got a 12-year-old on a dirt bike.
He was, well, when this was filmed, he would have been probably about 13 years old.
Okay. So in real life, you've got a 13 on what looked like maybe a Yamaha or a Honda 125,
yeah,
being chased by a Terminator on a Harley Fat Boy.
Well, actually, he's being chased by...
Well, being chased by the T-1000.
And then the Harley chasing them.
Yeah, in a semi-tow truck.
Yes.
Flat-nosed, I think it was a Peterbilt semi-truck tow truck. So it's the biggest ultra-heavy one.
Right.
And then the Harley chasing it.
Right. Yeah. And then there's really, you know, some cool, like the jumps and everything. Okay. Here's what I was going to get into it.
Yeah.
And I remember this, especially from the Guns N' Roses video, because that scene is there where Arnold, or when the Terminator jumps the bike in front of the tow truck.
Yeah.
Off of he basically comes off the off ramp and like jumps over, you know, and gets in front of him. And he's like chasing down John Connor, trying to, you know, pick him up, everything.
Yeah.
I remember even then, like watching that and going, dude, they could have at least gotten a stunt dude that kind of looked like Arnold Schwarzenegger in the face.
Yeah.
And last night, rewatching it, every time that you see something, it's like, dude, just because you threw glasses on him doesn't hide the fact that that is not Arnold Schwarzenegger on that bike.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I've seen that in other movies too, where it's like, oh, that was an obvious stunt person, you know.
And there is no way that they actually landed that bike like they did. They obviously jumped that off into a soft pack
something
somewhere.
I know. And you know, and then the whole whenever he like reaches over and grabs John Connors off of his bike and then like pulls him onto his, I'm like, yeah. I want to know how they did that.
Yeah.
That was obviously they were on, because you don't see the entire bike, you only see it from like the handlebars up or whatever. It's like, oh, obviously they did that.
They're probably on a flatbed.
They are on the flatbed, and they just they did the whole, you know, and they had him on a harness, you know, and everything. And it's like, okay, that was my biggest. I was like, there were several shots during that sequence where I was like, you could have blurred the face or something just to try to, you know,
motion blur. Yeah, I mean, that's a good use of motion blur, yeah, right just, there.
Man,
yeah,
it's like, man, it is obvious that that is not him. So anyway,
yeah.
I think it was shortly after that that I kind of, well, that was, you know, that was the whole when he calls back home because he wants to warn his foster parents, and they ask the whole, like, you know, what's your dog's name? And it's Max, and he's like, how's Woofy doing? Oh, Woofy's doing great, and blah blah blah.
Just hangs up the phone. He's like, your foster parents are dead.
Yeah, it's yeah, no, it's
like, what?
Yeah, and so yeah, there's
but,
and then
but that gave Knife Hand a whole new meaning.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Cool. Yeah,
yeah.
I got to, I guess where I stopped was after the breakout from the mental hospital,
yeah,
was shortly. It was basically when they were driving in the car.
Yeah,
you know, and like he's kind of filling her in
on what's going on.
What's going on? Yeah. And of course,
she's asking questions and giving directives.
Right,
and she's now in control.
Right, but he's also like, she's getting on John about, you know, I told you, you know, don't come for me. You can't do that. Yeah. You know, and everything. You're more important than this. And
They hole up in that garage. They pull the bullets out of the Terminator and kind of sew everybody up. And that's when they start heading towards Mexico.
Right. Let me say this. I remember Linda Hamilton being attractive.
Oh, yeah.
I forgot just how attractive she was until I watched this again last night.
Well, I mean, she was really attractive in the first one.
Right.
In this one,
she bulked up in this one, too.
She didn't just bulk up. Yeah. She toned out.
I know.
And like, I don't think there was any body fat on her whatsoever.
But, I mean, but she, like, when she's doing those pull-ups, I mean, I was just like, dang, dude, that is, yeah. But, yeah, that was just a wow. I could believe it. Yeah, so then they head to Mexico, and
that's where they go down and they get the guns and the supplies, and, you know, they get the, I think it was a Bronco or something.
Yes.
And they're supposed to keep going south.
Right.
And that's when Linda Hamilton's character takes off to go kill Dyson.
Right, because she's going to try to, because she had attempted to blow up that factory.
Yeah.
That's what
wound, once before.
That's what wound her up in the hospital.
Psychiatric ward, yeah.
And,
instead, she decides to go to his house with a sniper rifle.
Right.
Well, it wasn't even really a sniper rifle. It was...
Well, you know, the whole thing, we go through... obviously, we get to the point where they beat the Terminator because... And the whole thing is because they say, you know, because they found out that the way that they had... because they thought they had...
destroyed
stopped
everything.
Stopped it to begin with. But what happened is because, you know, they had killed the first term... the T-500 the first time in a metal press. And what happened is that people, they got a hold of
the arm and the microprocessor that was in the head.
And so that's what still made everything go forward because they were like, okay, well, you know, so this is how it happens. Well, we can stop this.
Yeah.
And so that was the whole, you see, you know, the whole thing with, in order to make sure that it didn't happen again, they're at the molten factory, you know, they're at the factory.
Well, it was a metal smelting factory.
Right. And so you see that where the T-500 sacrifices himself and, you know, basically melts himself down to make sure that this couldn't happen again. And we're left on a
high note.
On a high note of, hey, we stopped this thing. Fast forward a few years to Terminator 3.
Rise of the Machines,
and it's one of those things where, again, we've got an older John Connor who's like he's in his 20s at the time, I think, or something
and
like that.
Complete vagabond, living off grid, hiding because he's not convinced.
Right, and it's one of those things because, like, when he comes back this time, I've only seen two of these in the theater. That was the first one I saw in the theater.
Yeah,
and it was, I remember him telling, because he asked about Sarah Connor, you know, and he says she died of cancer, but that she died, she's basically, because it was supposed to happen in, what, 97?
Yeah.
It was like, I forget, whatever. She died, like, shortly thereafter. She made sure that she lived long enough to make sure that the apocalypse didn't, the machine apocalypse didn't happen, you know, type stuff. What we learned in that that movie is that there was no stopping it. It was something that was going to happen no matter what.
Yeah.
That's how, that has one of the most bummer endings of a movie ever, of them, like him and his girlfriend in a bunker, basically hunkering down as the nukes are going off.
Who's the actress?
It was Claire Danes.
Claire Danes, yeah.
And of them hunkering down as the bombs are going off.
Still have a thing for Claire Danes.
And he... Did you ever see Stardust?
Don't think so.
You need to see Stardust. If you love Claire Danes, you need to see Stardust.
Okay.
It's actually based on a children's book that Neil Gaiman wrote.
Really?
And it's a fantasy movie. It's got, what's his name? Charlie Cox, that played Daredevil.
Yeah.
He is like kind of the main protagonist in
it. Okay, I'll have to look it up.
And Claire Danes plays a fallen star.
Oh.
And Robert De Niro has he's got like a small role in it.
Yeah.
He's got one of the best roles of his entire career.
Really?
Yes. You need to see it. It's a fantasy movie. Like literally, like, you know, it's like there's magic and there's, you know, and all this kind of stuff.
I'll have to look that one up.
I'm telling everybody that I have said, you need to go watch this movie, when they've watched it, they're like, how did I miss this? It's like, because it didn't do well in theaters. Like, I saw it in the theater. I had been told by someone, like, you really ought to see this movie.
Yeah.
And Claire Danes just, no pun intended, she shines in this movie. it's one of those things, it's like,
total
pun
intended.
I know, but
yeah.
Yeah, actually, because there's actually a whole plot with that situation.
Gotcha, yeah.
But it's one of those things where it's like, wow, this! I wish more people knew about this movie.
Okay. Well, so we just let a whole bunch of people see
Stardust.
Yeah, Stardust. There you go. Okay, back to Terminator 2.
Well worth it. So yeah, so it's
or Terminator 3 at this point, Rise of the Machines. Yeah.
So it's one of those things where it has one of the most bummer endings, where it's like basically it pulls back and you're seeing the nukes going off around the world.
Yeah.
And there is a voiceover, you know, saying, you know, no, you can't stop fate. Basically, is what it comes down to. Okay, so it's funny because I remember like even watching this last night, the parts of it that I did see, I'm thinking, okay, this franchise has been rebooted at least 4 times. Because 2 is a reboot. 2 is a complete, I know it's a sequel, but it's a complete reboot also.
It is.
Okay, Arnold Schwarzenegger is a big star now.
Yeah.
He wasn't when he made this movie, and so he can't be the bad guy. He's got to be the good guy. So we got to reboot this to where the T-500 is now the good guy.
Yeah.
Okay, so we got this reboot. Okay, then you get
which it actually wasn't a bad movie.
It wasn't, it made, you know, it makes sense.
Yeah,
I've got to send someone back in time that can fight this thing. It's got to be one of the robots, and if I send just a regular robot, they're never going to believe.
Yeah,
that I've got to send somebody back that they're going to recognize, even if they recognize them for the wrong reasons.
Yeah,
at least, you know, type thing. So, 3 is another reboot because basically at the end of 2, hey, we stopped everything. Everything's good. Well,
yeah.
High note. 3 is you can't stop anything.
Yeah, so okay. I see what you're saying there, yeah.
4, I did not see 4. I know 4 was at Genesis.
I actually enjoyed Genesis.
Genesis or was it Salvation?
Hold on. I'm actually...
That was Salvation. The one with Christian Bale where it's set in the...
Oh, Peoria, yeah. That was
which
Salvation.
Which I've never seen.
I actually enjoyed that one. It's got a twist.
I've never seen that one. And I've only heard bad things about it.
It's not a great movie.
Right.
But I have watched it 2 or 3... You know, because it'll come on.
Right.
And I'll be like, yeah, I'm going to watch this.
Okay. Then there was...
And I'm not really watching it for Christian Bale. It's the other character... That actually plays
that, like John Connors is kind of like he's not really the main character.
No, he is not.
Yeah,
no, he is not.
It's before he becomes the lead of the resistance and everything.
Yeah.
Then there was Terminator: The Sarah Connor Chronicles, the television show. Did you ever watch that?
I tried to watch some of
it. It's really good. Like I watched it because it was only 2 seasons long, and really the first season. Is like 13 episodes. It was a mid-season replacement, you know, that came on in the spring, but it did so well. They're like, okay, we'll bring this back.
And it had
first.
Summer Glau as the
She played the Terminator,
yeah.
But Lena Headey that played Stark. Not Stark, I'm sorry.
Lannister?
Yeah, what's the the mom.
Cersei.
She plays Cersei.
Cersei
plays
Lannister.
Plays Sarah Connor. Which is funny, because you have Cersei Lannister playing Sarah Connor, and then in Genesis, you have Daenerys Targaryen playing Sarah Connor. So, but it was one of those things, it was actually pretty interesting, because it's a time travel. But you know who plays the T-1000 in the television show?
No.
Shirley Manson.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
That's cool.
Yeah. But the thing is it's a time travel show. Like, it starts off in like 1995 or 7 or whatever it is, you know?
Yeah.
And then it jumps ahead to like current time, which was like 2008 or something at the time, you know, because they wind up going into the future. And they also bring in Kyle Reese's brother.
Okay.
Into this.
That's an interesting
storyline. It's a really cool storyline of and it's played by, and it's funny because the show was kind of for the first couple episodes, and then they bring this character in, and he's played by Brian Austin Green. And he actually, like, when that character came on the show really got a lot better all of a sudden.
Yeah.
But it really deals with a lot of, like, jumping. And it's also during that in the show is when she gets the cancer diagnosis.
Okay.
So it really is in the timeline, like in the, you know, whatever. I'll be honest, I didn't finish out the second season of it all the way. And it also ended, like, they didn't give it a proper ending. So how everything got set back into the timeline properly, I'm not sure exactly how it happened. But then you have Genesis that came out after that.
Salvation. No. Then Genesis.
Okay.
Genesis.
Yeah. Salvation was the one with Christian Bale, right?
Yes.
And then Sarah Connor Chronicles came out, and then it was Genesis. And I have not seen this one either. And I know that if they make John Connor's the bad guy in that one, like he's actually a Terminator or something.
Yes.
Yeah. And I was just like,
I'm trying to think, what was the one that had the female Terminator?
Dark Fate.
Was that Dark Fate?
That's the last one, yeah. I've seen that one. I actually enjoyed that one quite a bit. Because it's one of those things that they brought Linda Hamilton back. And what's her name? Mackenzie, I forget what her last name, that played the hybrid. She's a hybrid, basically. She was on a show called Halt and Catch Fire.
Yeah, absolutely.
I love that
show.
That
was a great show, yeah.
There's your recommend. 4 seasons, it was on AMC, and like every season's like 13 episodes or something, so you don't have to put a whole lot of time into it. But it's all about the early days of computers.
Silicon Valley.
It's not Silicon Valley. It's the Silicon Prairie in Texas.
Well, yeah, that's
true. They deal a lot with like Texas Instruments and a bunch of that type of stuff. So it's really pretty cool.
Genesis, basically, they send Kyle Reese back, and just as they're sending him back, one of the machines actually gets a hold of John Connor, and Skynet basically embeds him with nanites and turns him into basically Skynet flesh.
Okay.
He's basically Skynet now has a body.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know. I'd heard, again, bad things about
once
that.
Again, it...
I would, I, you know,
I'm a sucker for B grade action films, and especially the Terminator series. Mm-hmm. So I can't. I mean,
I'll be honest,
they're not great movies, but they're not terrible movies.
The only reason
either.
That I saw Dark Fate is because they brought Linda Hamilton back, and not only that, but also James Cameron actually produced he hadn't the previous three. So.
I'm not gonna lie, I watched it for exactly the same reasons. Mm-hmm. Hamilton was back, and you know, James Cameron was writing it, directing it, and all that. I have never been so angry.
A lot of people hate that movie.
I do.
Of all
the movies that came out that everybody talked bad about, that's the one I hate.
Really?
Because
I really liked it. So,
I mean, they've survived. You know,
that's the whole thing. They killed John Connor in the opening, like, five minutes of the movie.
Let me finish what I was saying. Is basically they went from Terminator 2, they made it to Mexico, they're celebrating, hey, we made it, and a T-500, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger is the T-500, shows up
and
kills John
Connor
immediately, and she's no longer, you know, the savior, and the task of stopping the rise of the machines jumps to another person.
Right.
And I'm like, no. Screw you.
But again, they have played with that timeline so much over the. So why would that? It makes perfect sense. Because seriously, they stopped it, and then they find out they can't stop it, and then, you know, they with Genesis, they turn the hero of the story into the bad guy.
Yeah, but
and
then they. But I this mean, doesn't just, even take into account any of the other movies.
Right.
It was literally there to go Terminator, Terminator 2.
Dark Fate.
Dark Fate.
Right.
And it was James Cameron going, you know, all those other people that put in all this work, screw all y'all.
Yeah.
You know, I made Titanic.
It happens, but that happens. Like, look at what they just with Halloween. You know, they basically went with that last Halloween movie that came out. They said, okay, everything from past the first Halloween didn't happen.
No, Halloween 2.
No. With that timeline, Halloween 2 never happened.
I'm going to have to go back and rewatch it.
If you go back, it's basically...
Because Halloween 2 is just a continuation of...
continuation, I know. But if I'm not mistaken, with this current timeline of the Halloween movies, they wiped out everything from 2 on.
I'm going to have to go back and watch it because I think it includes 2.
It might. It might, but even then, you're still wiping out 6 movies. Well, you know? That's true. You know,
and not even counting the Rob Zombie reboots, exactly. Which I thoroughly enjoyed.
I like the first one, yeah. Second one, not so much.
You didn't like the second one?
I did not like the second one. I tried. I even went back and tried to re. Like, I watched it the first time and really just did not like it. Now, it wasn't one of those, like, oh, this is a piece of crap. It's just like, it just didn't grab me, okay? And then I went back and tried to rewatch it again, and I was like, oh, yeah, I don't like this movie. So.
Ooh, hold on. That reminds me of something.
Uh-oh.